الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. In our last session, we spoke about the Daru Dunya. We spoke about this dunya and its reality. And we said that inshaAllah ta'ala, we have two more parts, two more sessions. The second session we'll speak about Darul Barzakh, which is today inshaAllah ta'ala. And the third sit or the third session we'll be speaking about Darul Qarar, the hereafter. And the individual, the believer or the non-believer, or the disbeliever, we will go through those three stages, la mahal. There's no way out of it. You go through hayatu dunya, amadaru dunya, this world, and then there will come a day where this time will finish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازْ وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. That this life will come to an end. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will taste death. Allah told the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he said to him, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ أَفَإِن مِتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ. Muhammad, we have not made anyone live after we have brought death to you, Muhammad. Do they think or do you assume that you're going to live? No one's going to live. Allah says in another ayah, أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدْرِكُمُ الْمَوْتُ وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. That death will come to you even if you are in a steel house. It will come to you one day. So if you see somebody die, it's a matter of months, days, weeks, hours, years maybe, before you take that person's place and be a person who's passing away. So this life will come to an end. And we spoke about that in great details last time. Today we're going to speak about Hayatul Barzakh. Darul Barzakh. The Barzakh, what does it mean? It means a station between the dunya and the hereafter. It's a life that is in between. The salaf of hadhihi al-ummah, the pious predecessors, what they used to do is because they knew they were going to die and because they knew death will come to them, they used to put themselves in a position where they would prepare themselves that if death actually came, it wouldn't shock them. The poet, he said, يُمَثِّلُ ذُو اللُّبِّ فِي لُبِّهِ مَصَائِبَ قَبْلَ أَن تَنْزِلَ فَإِنْ نَزَلَتْ بَغْتَةً لَمْ تَرُعْهُ لِمَا كَانَ فِي نَفْسِهِ مَثَّلَ وَذُو الْجَهْلِ يَا مَنْ أَيَّامَهُ وَيَنْسَى مَسَارِعَ مَنْ قَدْ خَلَى فَإِنْ دَهِمَتْهُ صُرُوفُ الزَّمَانِ بِبَعْضِ مَصَائِبِهِ أَعُلَى. They would dig a grave in their house. They will what? They will dig a grave in their own house. And they will lie inside it. They will lie inside the grave. يُمَثِّلُ ذُلُّبْ بِهِ. He would actually rehearse and play out the inevitable event that's going to take place. He will lie inside the grave. He will try to get the feeling of what it's going to be inside here. And then he will say, قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِي لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ. Oh Allah, take me back to the dunya again. Why? So I can come with righteous actions. This is what he will say. And then because he has the opportunity to come out this time, because he's the one who's rehearsing it, he will clean the dust from himself and then he will walk on the earth and he will say, a second chance has been given to you, benefit from it. He say that to himself. وَلِذَلِكَ الصَّحَابَةَ, when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam would speak about the death, they would cry radiallahu ta'ala anhum, and it would affect them. Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anha, Ama radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, may Allah be pleased with her and her father, She said, قام رسول الله, the messenger stood up one day. صلى الله عليه وسلم خطيبا. He stood up to give a sermon. فذكر, the messenger mentioned فتنة القبر, the trials and the tribulations in the grave, the عذاب, and the punishment that's going to take place in the grave. The messenger started to talk about it. التي يفتن فيها المرء. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he spoke about the fitna that a person will go through if he goes against Allah's command in the grave. When the messenger spoke about it in great details, فَلَمَّا ذَكَرَ ذَلِكَ ضَجَّ, when the messenger mentioned that, the people who were in the messenger's gathering, they started to cry, they started to weep. ضَجَّ الْمُسْلِمُونَ ضَجَّ, those who were around him, they started to cry and weep until the noise became very loud in the masjid. Al-Imam al-Bukhari narrated this in his Sahih. They felt it. They knew the reality of what awaits them. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us about the adab al-qabr. And he told us that it has reasons and things that bring it about. We'll speak about that in great details. But wallahi, brothers, the most prosperous person, the most noble person, the person who's truly loved by Allah, is the one, مَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ, the person whose life is long, وَحَسُنَ عَمَلُهُ, and his actions are good. Anyone who's lived a very long life, but life full of righteous deeds. What is a life full of righteous deeds? It's a life where you follow what Allah tells you to do and you stay away from that which He told you to stay away from. That is a life full of righteous deeds. Because you as a believer, your master Allah Azza wa Jalla, He gives you commands you need to follow, and He prohibits you and you need to stay away from them. Wallahi, if you do those two, you do what you're told to do, and you stay away from that which you've been told to stay away from, you've come with righteous deeds. And you are a righteous person. The Messenger told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, in a hadith Anas ibn Malik narrated, and Al-Imam Abu Dawood narrated in his Sunan, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he said, لَمَّا عُرِجَ بِي, when I was ascended, the night of Isra wal-Mi'raj, مَرَرْتُ بِقَوْمٍ, I came by a group of people, لَهُمْ أَظْفَارٌ, they have nails, مِنْ نُحَاسٍ, out of copper, I'm a metal rod, يَخْمِشُونَ وُجُوهَهُمْ وَصُدُورَهُمْ, what are they doing? They are ripping their faces and their chests. فَقُلْتُ النَّبِيُّ Muhammad, when he saw this, he asked Jibreel, he said to him, مَنْ هَؤُلَاءِ يَا Jibreel, Jibreel, who are these people that are doing this? قَالَ, the messenger said, هَؤُلَاءِ الَّذِينَ, these ones who are being destroyed like this, يَأْكُلُونَ لُحُومَ النَّاسِ, they are the ones who are eating and biting through the people's flesh. وَيَقَعُونَ فِي أَعْرَاضِهِمْ, and they're belittling the people's honor. They're the ones who sit and they backbite and they talk about people and they go deep into people's honor. Name calling, belittling. This is from the things that bring about adab al-qabr, the punishment of the grave. And this hadith in its length, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to go through it. Brothers and sisters, adab al-qabr is in its present, I mean the evidence for it is in the Quran, and it's also in the, it's in the Sunnah. From the evidence is Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated, Aisha said, دَخَلَتْ عَلَيَّ عَجُوزَانِ مِنْ عُجُزِ الْيَهُودِ, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, two old women from the old women of Medina, they were Jews, they were not Muslims, two old Jew women from the elders of Medina entered and came in. فَقَالَتَا لِي, both the women, they said to Aisha radiallahu anhu, the two old women are saying to who? Our mother Aisha, they said to her, إِنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُبُورِ, the people of the graves, those who are living in the graves, يُعَذَّبُونَ فِي قُبُورِهِمْ, they will be punished in their graves. The people who are in their graves are going to be punished in their graves. فَكَذَّبْتُهُمَا, Aisha said, I said that you're lying. You're not telling the truth. I didn't believe them. وَلَمْ أُنْعِمْ أَنْ أُصَدِّقَهُمَا, and it didn't please me for me to believe them. Why would I believe that? Adab al-qabr? Because Aisha hasn't heard of this yet. فَخَرَجَتَا Both of the women, they left. وَدَخَلَ عَلَيَّ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ The messenger entered. فَقُلْتُ لَهُ I said to the Prophet, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ O Messenger of Allah, إِنَّ عَجُوزَيْنِ Two old women from the old women of Medina came to me. And I told them what they told me. فَقَالَ The messenger said, صَدَقَتَا Both of those women told you the truth. What they told you is true. إِنَّهُمْ Verily the people in the graves, يُعَذَّبُونَ عَذَابًا They will be punished a punishment. تَسْمَعُهُ الْبَهَائِمُ كُلُّهَا The animals, they will hear the screaming and the wailing that's coming from the people of the grave. All of the inhabitants and those who are in the grave, they will hear it. تَسْمَعُهُ الْبَهَائِمُ كُلُّهَا As Imam al-Bukhari narrated this. Aisha then said, فَمَا رَأَيْتُ From that day onwards, I never saw Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam إِلَّا تَعَوَّدَ مِنْ عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ He would always seek refuge in Allah from the punishment of the grave. Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, بَيْنَمَا النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي حَائِطٍ لِبَنِي نَجَّارِ The messenger one day, he was on his riding beast, عَلَى بَغْلَةٍ لَهُ He was mounted on his riding beast. And he came by a garden owned by who? Bani Najjar. That was a tribe. They owned it. The messenger was upon a mule. He was upon a mule. He mounted on top of it, alayhi salatu wasalam. Zayd ibn Thabit said, وَنَحْنُ مَعَهُ We were with him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِذْ حَادَتْ بِهِ فَكَادَتْ تُلْقِيهِ The riding beast, it went fast when the messenger came into the garden. It went so fast until the messenger was about to fall from it. The animal, what did it do? It went extremely fast. It had that it took speed. فَكَادَتْ تُلْقِيهِ It was about to throw the messenger from its back. وَإِذَا أَقْبُرٌ When the messenger looked around, there were six, أو خمسة أو five أو أربعة أو four. The narrator was confused. How much graves were there? These number of graves were around the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to the companions, من يعرف أصحاب هذه الأقبور? Who knows the inhabitants of these graves? Who knows who's inside these graves? Does anyone amongst you know those who are in these graves? فقال رجل أنا A man said, I know who these people are. I know who the people who are in these graves are. And then the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to him, Okay, فمتى مات هؤلاء? When did these people die? And what did they die upon? The man, he said, ماتوا في الإشراك. They died upon shirk. They were associating partners with Allah عز وجل. Then the Messenger, then look what he said. He said, إن هذه الأمة Verily this ummah, تُبْتَلَى فِي قُبُورِهَا It will be tested in their graves. Verily this ummah, they will be tested in their graves. فَلَوْلَا أَلَّا تَدَافَنُوا If I was not scared that you will not bury your dead, لَدَعَوْتُ اللَّهِ I would have supplicated to Allah. I, Muhammad, would have begged Allah. For what? أَنْ يُسْمِعَكُمْ That he allows you to hear مِنْ عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ الَّذِي أَسْمَعُهُ مِنْهُ I will ask Allah that He allows you to hear the punishment of the grave the way I hear it. But the problem is, if you heard it, you would throw away your dead relatives and you hang them on trees. You wouldn't want to bury them after what you hear that comes from the grave. وَلِذَلِكَ This is what made Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He used to cry. Al-Imam At-Tirmidhi narrated, that Hani Mawla Uthman, Hani was a slave boy of Uthman ibn Affan. He said, Kana Uthman was one, إِذَا وَقَفَ عَلَى قَبْرٍ بَكَى حَتَّى يَبُلَّ لِحْيَتَهُ Uthman was one that would cry, if he stood over a grave, he would cry until his beard will be full with tears. Just crying, the tears that come out of his eyes will fill his beard. It will make his beard soak, wet. Uthman radiallahu anhu. And you have to understand, Uthman is a man who has been promised Jannah alive. While he's walking on this earth, he was informed, he was told that the only thing between you and entering Jannah is death. You're going to enter Jannah. So he knows that he's going to enter Jannah. So whenever he stood over a grave, or whenever he would see a grave, Uthman would cry until his beard would be filled with tears. So they said to him, تُذْكَرُ الْجَنَّةُ وَالنَّارِ. The Jannah is mentioned, the Nar is mentioned. فَلَا تَبْكِي. You don't cry. وَتَبْكِي مِنْ هَذَا. But when you come to the grave, you cry. You don't cry when Jannah is spoken about or Nar is spoken about, but you cry when you speak, when you stand over a grave. Why? And look what he said. He said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said. This is why Uthman cried more for the qabr. He said the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, إن القبر, the grave, is أول منازلي. It's the first stage. الآخرة, the stages of the hereafter. فإن نجا منه, if the person makes it through the grave, فما بعده أيسر منه. Everything after it for him is easy. وإن لم ينجو, if he doesn't make it through the grave, فما بعده أشد منه. Everything and anything after it is hard. And then look what he said. قال وقال رسول الله. Also the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, ما رأيت منظرا قط. I never saw a reality. I never saw an event. I never saw a matter more severe and despicable than the grave. ما رأيت منظرا قط إلا والقبر أفضع منه. The Prophet said, I have not seen any sight except that what? Except that the grave is more horrible than it. So this is why Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to cry more about the affairs of the grave than he would cry regarding the adab al-qabr, the adab of the day of judgment. I'm going to go through a lengthy hadith. This hadith is the hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azib. Al-Imam Abu Dawood narrated this hadith in his Sunan. I'm going to read that version. But the lengthy version and the lengthy narration, you will find it in Musnad Imam Ahmad. Where would you find it? In Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. And Ibn Kathir, in his tafsir, he brings it in the ayah, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ ثَابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ وَيُضِلُّ اللَّهُ الظَّالِمِينَ وَيَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ. Ibn Kathir, when he comes to that ayah in Surah Ibrahim, he brings the lengthy version of Imam Ahmad's Musnad. So you can find it there, inshaAllah ta'ala. But we will go through the summarized version due to the time, because we have other narrations to go through. Al-Bara ibn Azib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, خَرَجْنَا مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. We went with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. فِي جَنَازَةِ رَجُلٍ مِّنَ الْأَنصَارِ. خَرَجْنَا, we came out. مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, with the Messenger. Together. We came up with the Prophet of Allah. For what? فِي جَنَازَةِ رَجُلٍ. Towards a burial of a man. This man was from the people of Ansar. فَانْتَهِيْنَا إِلَى الْقَبْرِ. We came to the grave. We came to the grave. فَجَلَسَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. The Messenger sat down. عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Messenger sat down. وَجَلَسْنَا حَوْلَهُ. We sat around him. The Prophet sat down, we all sat down with him. كَأَنَّمَا عَلَى رُؤُوسِنَا الطَّيْرِ. It was like a bird was on our heads. Why did the narrator say that? Because the bird, it only stands on a place which is still. A place that doesn't move. We were so still. No one was moving. Everybody was calm. No one moved. It was like birds were on our heads. The moment was a very sad, painful moment for us. The Messenger sat down, we all sat around him, and we all went quiet. No one was moving. كَأَنَّمَا عَلَى رُؤُوسِنَا الطَّيْرِ وَفِي يَدِهِ عُودٌ. The Prophet had a twig, a small little twig. يَنْكُتُ بِهِ فِي الْأَرْضِ. He was scribbling, or he was drawing on the earth. This is an indication of the frustration, the pain that the companions and the Messenger were enduring. So that twig He was scribbling on the earth. فَرَفَعَ رَأْسَهُ. Then the messenger raised his head. After a while of silence, no one talking, the messenger raised his head because he was looking down. The messenger raised his head. And then he said, استعيذوا بالله من عذاب القبر. Seek refuge in Allah from the punishment of the grave. The messenger said this twice or thrice, three times. He said this twice or three times. And then the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام وإنه ليسمع خفق نعليهم إذا ولوا مدبرين يقال له. The messenger told us that that man in the grave, when everybody leaves him, he will hear the footprints of the last person walking away. As soon as the last person leaves, he will be told to sit up, and then he will be questioned, interrogated. It will be then said to him, يا هذا, you, مَنْ رَبُّكَ وَمَا دِينُكَ وَمَا نَبِيُّكَ. These are the three questions he's going to be asked. Simple questions, like many won't be able to answer. The sad reality is, it's an exam in which its question and its answers have already been given to us, and some people are still going to fail. You've already been told the questions, and you've also been told the answer to give. And then when you come to the exam, you still fail. What excuse do you have? Who do you blame except yourself? So the first person, he will say, when he's asked, مَنْ رَبُّكَ فَيَقُولُ, the first righteous slave of Allah, he will say, رَبِّي Allah, Allah is my Lord. فَيَقُولَانِ لَهُ. Then they say to him, مَا دِينُكَ, what's your religion? فَيَقُولُ, this person will say, دِينِيَ الْإِسْلَامِ, my religion is Islam. فَيَقُولَانِ لَهُ. Then they will say to him, مَا هَذَا الرَّجُلُ, who is this man? الَّذِي بُعِثَ فِيكُمْ, that was sent out from amongst you. Who is this man? And then he would say, هُوَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, this is the messenger of Allah, صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَيَقُولَانِ. Then they will say to him, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ, what has made you know this? How did you come to know all this? How were you able to answer these questions? فَيَقُولُ, look what he will say, قَرَأْتُ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ, I read the book of Allah. فَآمَنْتُ بِهِ, I believed in it. وَصَدَّقْتُ, and my limbs followed in adherence towards it. It wasn't just a mere belief. I believed it in my heart, and my limbs, they followed it. What I believed became actions for me. That's the people who are going to be able to answer it. So it's not just the knowledge that you know. It's, did you live by this concept? رَبِّي اللَّهِ, Allah is my Lord. Did you live by Islam is my religion? That when the religion told you this is haram, you're not allowed to do it. Did you give the religion more precedence? And did you give that more rights? Or did you give your own nafs and follow it? Allah says in the Quran, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَاهُ. You took your Lord as your desires, and Allah was nothing to you. Whenever your nafs called you to something which was haram, instead of staying away from it, what did you do? You gave precedence to your desires. أَفَرَأَيْتَ, do you not see? مَنْ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ, he has taken his Lord, what? هَوَى. So would he be able to answer that person? Will he be able to answer when he's asked, مَنْ رَبُّكَ? Would he be able to say, رَبِّي Allah? How could he say, رَبِّي Allah? His Rabb was his what? His desires. That was his Rabb, that's what he worshipped, that's what he lived by. That's what his concern was. Then the hadith mentioned, the Prophet ﷺ, look what he read. After that, the Prophet said, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. This person came with belief. Allah is going to make the believers firm that day. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوَعَدُونَ. These are righteous people, brothers. These are the people who said, Allah is my Lord, and they were steadfast. They stuck by it under every circumstances that came. Whether it was tough, whether it was hard, when there was a need to take this riba, they said, no, I can't. How am I going to face Allah the day of judgment? How am I going to take money? I know it's haram. We'll speak about it later. From the punishments of the adab al-qabr is those who take riba, those who take usury. They're going to be from the people who are going to taste adab al-qabr if they don't repent from it and they don't come back from it. Like in the disbelievers, the criminals, that day Allah is going to destroy them. As Allah said in the ayah, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا أَوْ قَالَ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ وَلَمْ يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ شَيْءٌ وَمَنْ قَالَ سَأُنْزِلُ مِثْلَ مَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ وَلَوْ تَرَى إِذِ الظَّالِمُونَ فِي غَمَرَاتِ الْمَوْتِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ بَاسِطُ أَيْدِيهِمْ أَخْرِجُوا أَنفُسَكُمُ الْيَوْمَ تُجْزَوْنَ عَذَابَ الْهُونِ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ غَيْرَ الْحَقِّ وَكُنْتُمْ عَنْ آيَاتِهِ تَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. The angels would destroy him at that moment in the grave. And he would be humiliated in the grave. All because why? He didn't come with what was commanded from him, and he didn't stay away from that which he was told to stay away from. That's really the real reason why he's being destroyed. Look at the disbeliever. Look at the criminal. The angels will come to him. Before they come to him, sorry, let's look at what happens for the believer. After he answers these questions, what happens? Then, فَيُنَادِي مُنَادِي مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. A caller will call out from the sky. What will the caller say? أَنْ صَدَقَ عَبْدِي. My slave so-and-so, wallah, he told the truth. It's true, he read the book of Allah. It's true, he believed it. It's true, he adhered to it. He's telling the truth. So what should we do? فَأَفْرِشُوا مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ. Open for him, Jannah. Spread it out for him. وَافْتَحُوا لَهُ بَابًا. Open a door for him, a window for him in his grave. وَأَلْبِسُوهُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ. And clothe him from Jannah. So what's going to happen? The doors, the grave, there's going to be wind from Jannah that's going to come to him. The grave will be made into what? Wide. The narration mentions until he's where, how far his eyes can see. It's going to be made. It's going to be open for him. It's going to be spread out for him. Before he enters Jannah, he's actually in Jannah, because Allah made his grave for him what? Riyadun min riyadil Jannah. A garden from the gardens of Jannah for him. So this one, what would he say? He said, Allahumma aqim sa'ah. Allahumma aqim sa'ah. Oh Allah, bring the hour. I want the day of judgment to happen. I want the hour to happen, because he knows what he's done. The second one. Wa innal kafira, the disbeliever, the criminal, the wrongdoer. What will happen to him? It will be said to him, Man Rabbuka, who's your Lord? فَيَقُولُ, he will say, ha, ha, ha. He can't answer the question. فَيَقُولَانِ لَهُ, then they will say to him, مَا دِينُكُ, what's your religion? He will say, ha, ha. He doesn't have an answer. He cannot answer. فَيُنَادِي then he says, مَا هَذَا الرَّجُلُ الَّذِي بُعِثَ فِيكُمْ. Who is this man that was sent out from amongst you? He will say, ha, ha, I don't know. لَا أَدْرِي. فَيُنَادِي مُنَادِي مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. A caller will call out from the sky. And كَذَبَ فَأَفْرِشُ. This man is a liar, criminal, wrongdoer. What do you do? Make his grave a pit. حُفْرَ مِنْ حُفَرِ النَّارِ. A pit from the pits of the hellfire. And what do you also do? أَلْبِسُ مِنَ النَّارِ. Clothe him from the hellfire. Also do what? Bring his grave together. Squeeze him. The narration mentions, حَتَّى تَخْتَلِفَ أَضْلَاعُ. Until his ribs, they cross through. They go through. Are you with me, brothers? Some of the athar even mention that his internal intestines and his heart and his lungs, they squeeze out from his nose. The squeezing, they come out. This is how much he will be squeezed. And then the window of the hellfire will be open for him. فَيَأْتِيهِ مِنْ حَرِّهَا وَسُمُومِهَا. The smell, the heat. Your air conditioner in summer, if it doesn't work, what do you feel? Burning inside the house. Remember that it is nothing compared to Jahannam. It is nothing compared to the heat that comes from Jahannam. So the hot heat will come in. His chest is squeezed. And the adab starts from him here. And then what does he say? Allahumma la taqim sah. Allah, don't make the hour come. Because Jahannam is worse than what he's going through right now. These are, brothers, as we said, these are the paths of the two people. فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ. A people are heading towards Jannah. And another group of people are heading towards what? They're heading towards Jahannam. They're heading towards the hellfire. Some people might say, well, that hadith is talking about the disbelievers. What about the mu'mineen who have come with major sins? They're believers, they're not disbelievers, but they came with what? They came with major sins. There is a hadith for them. This hadith is very long. Al-Imam Abu Dawood, rahimahullah, he narrated it. This one we're going to go in great details, inshallah ta'ala. Al-Imam Al-Bukhari also narrated this hadith. Al-Imam Al-Bukhari narrated this hadith. Let's go through this hadith, inshallah ta'ala. Samurat ibn Jundubin, he said, it's a very long hadith. We'll take this hadith as a final point, inshallah ta'ala. He said, كان رسول الله, the messenger was one. مما يكثر أن يقول لأصحابه, the messenger, he used to excessively say to his companions. The messenger would say to his companions a lot. He would say to them, هل رأى أحد منكم رؤيا? Has anyone from amongst you, did anyone from amongst you see a dream last night? Every morning the Prophet would say that to his companions. He used to say this a lot. He would say to them, did any one of you see a dream last night? Then the narration says, هَلْ رَأَى أَحَدٌ مِنْكُمْ رُؤْيَا قَالَ فَيَقُصُّ عَلَيْهِ مَنْ شَاءَ أَنْ يَقُصَّ. Anyone who had seen a dream, who wanted to share their dream, they would share it. And the messenger would listen. وَإِنَّهُ قَالَ ذَاتُ غَدَاتٍ. One day, one morning, the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّهُ أَتَانِ اللَّيْلَةِ. This last night, two angels came to me. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, last night, two people came to me, and there were two angels. They came to me. أَنَّهُ أَتَانِ اللَّيْلَةَ آتِيَانِ. Two individuals came to me. وَإِنَّهُمَا بْتَعَثَانِ وَإِنَّهُمَا قَالَ لِنْطَلِقْ. Both of them, they came to me and they said, we were set out for you, Muhammad. Come, let's go. Proceed. Go forward. فَانْطَلَقْتُ. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, إِنِّي انْطَلَقْتُ مَعَهُمَا. I went with them. وَإِنَّا أَتَيْنَا عَلَى رَجُلٍ مُضَّجِعٍ. This was the night of Isra wal-Mi'raj, some of the scholars mentioned. And remember, the dreams of prophets are considered to be what? Wahi is a revelation, it's not khayaliyat. This is what the Prophet saw. All of these people that are getting punished that we're going to see, all of them are the people of the graves. So we're going to go through each punishment. The first one he said is, I came across a man. This man was lying down. وَإِذَا آخَرٌ قَائِمٌ عَلَيْهِ بِصَخْرَةٍ. And another man was standing over his head. بِصَخْرَةٍ, with a stone. وَإِذَا هُوَ يَهْوِي بِالصَّخْرَةِ لِرَأْسِهِ. And another man was standing over his head holding a big rock and was throwing the rock at the man's head, injuring his head, and his head cracks and he opens. فَيَثْلَعُ رَأْسُهُ أَمَا فَيَثْلَغُ رَأْسُهُ فَيَتَهَدْهَدُ الصَّخْرَةِ أَمَا الْحَجَرُ. The stone then, it rolls, it starts to move. When he hits it on his head, the stone falls down and it starts, this man's head cracks into two pieces. The one who threw it, he goes after the rock, the stone. He picks it up again. The other one's head comes back together. As soon as he gets the rock, the other one's head comes back together. He throws it at him again, and the cycle is like that. His head cracks, he picks up the rock again, and he keeps doing that to him. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, قَالَ قُلْتُ. I said to the angels, Subhanallah, مَا هَذَانِ. Who are these people? قَالَ لِي انطلق. They said to me, proceed, proceed. They don't want to answer it. And the two angels are Jibreel and Mikael. They said to انطلق, go, go, go forward. فَانطَلَقْنَا. The Prophet said, we went. فَأَتَيْنَا عَلَى رَجُلٍ. We came to a man. We came to a man. A metal rod was taken from his nose and it was ripped through to his back to the other side. From his cheek to his other side. And whenever they cut from his nose to the other side and his cheek here to the other side, by then the skin will heal and they will do it again. Keep doing it to him, ripping his mouth and his nose. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Subhanallah, exalted is Allah azza wa jalla. What is this? Ma hadhani? What is the situation of this? They said to me, Imtaliq, go, 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 proceed. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I came to a tannur. A tannur is a baking oven. I came. And in there was noises and sounds of group of people in there. And when he saw it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leaned forward to look to it. And he saw inside there and found naked men and naked women who were in there. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they're all burning, they're all naked and they're burning. And then I asked the angels, who are these? SubhanAllah, who are these people? They said to me, proceed, proceed, go forward. Then he said, I proceeded and I came to a river. The narrator said, I think. Or a red like blood. The narrator was confused. The Prophet ﷺ then said, we proceeded and there was a man was swimming. He went near him. A man is swimming and another man's on top of him. While there was a man swimming, he went near him, a man, and what he does is he throws a rock. It goes inside the one that's swimming in his mouth and it destroys his mouth. And he's made to swallow it. And when the rock comes out, he throws another rock. Meaning he can't eat nothing and he can't take anything else. He's made to swallow a rock. He's been punished like that. The Prophet ﷺ said, I said, SubhanAllah, what is this? And then the angels, they said to me, انطلق, go forward, go forward. فَأَتَيْنَا عَلَى رَجُلٍ, we came to a man. كَرِيهٍ, the man was, his appearance, it was very bad. It didn't look very good. Rather, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said his appearance was the worst form of appearance that you will ever see. And then I said to the angels, who is this man? And who is this individual? And then they said to me, انطلق, انطلق, go forward. All of this that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw, he asked about each one after. Or he, as he was asking, he was not being informed. After that, he came to the angels came up to him and they said to him, the first person that you saw. أَمَّا الرَّجُلُ الْأَوَّلِ الَّذِي أَتَيْتَ عَلَيْهِ, the first man that you saw, whose head was being cracked open, it is the man who sleeps from the obligatory prayer. It's the man, is the one who يَنَامُ عَنْ صَلَاتِ الْمَكْتُوبَةِ, he sleeps away from the Fajr comes in and he's sleeping. As for the man you saw, his mouth was being ripped and his nose was being ripped from his neck. This is the one who lies. فَيَكْذِبُ الْكَذْبَةِ, he will make a lie up. And what will happen? تَبْلُغُ الْآفَاقَ, it will reach everywhere. He'll write a status on Twitter or Instagram, made up. Or he will retweet a lie and this lie will spread everywhere. That's the punishment of that one. وَأَمَّا الرِّجَالُ وَالنِّسَى, as for the men and the women that you saw who were naked, they were the ones who were in the oven, they were burning inside it. What are they? فَإِنَّهُمُ الزُّنَّاتُ وَالزَّوَانِي, they were the ones who committed zina. Because the zina, the person's whole body enjoys it, right? The whole body's been burnt inside that fire. As for the man that you saw swimming, and another man was thrown a rock into his mouth and was made to swallow it, فَإِنَّهُ آكِلُ الرِّبَى, is the one who eats riba. What is he swimming in? The narration mentioned blood. Why? Because the one who's eating riba, he's sucking the people's blood. You're taking what's not your right. The akilu riba, the one who's taking riba, what is he taking? He's taking a person's earned effort. Are we all together? This is not your right. It's somebody else's haq you're taking unjustly. So you're swimming in the blood of the people's, and your mouth is being destroyed because that's what you try to swallow. What did you try to eat? You tried to eat. And it's from the things that will take you to the Adab al-Qabri. And the hadith is very, very long in its length. So the person needs to stay away from eating riba. There are many other things that bring about Adab al-Qabr, but we will stop there, inshallah ta'ala. I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla from the bottom of my heart that He bestows His mercy and allows us to stay away from those things that He prohibited, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala that He forgives for us for our shortcomings and our errors and the mistakes that we have come with. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna ala al-qawmi al-kafirin. اللهم اغفر لنا هزلنا وجدنا وخطأنا وعمدنا وكل ذلك عندنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم لا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك فينا ولا يرحمنا. رب آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها، أنت وليها ومولاها. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أستغفرك وأتوب إليه. Any questions? تفضل. In other words, when the person burns and they become ashes, for example, or not even that, somebody burns inside the house, you know, and something like that happens. Do you all know the famous hadith of the man who came to his children and then he said to his children, "In mittu fa'ahriquni," if I die, burn me until I become ashes. And then when a windy day comes, he said, take me outside and then spread me inside the wind. Because why? He said, لَإِن قَدَرَنِيَ اللَّهُ if Allah gets the ability to bring me together, لَيُعَذِّبُنِي عَذَابًا لَا يُعَذِّبُ أَحَدًا مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ Allah is going to punish me a punishment that He hasn't punished anybody. صح? Did He not? He said that, the man. And look, their children, what they done is they went different places, they spread his... And then what did Allah do? Allah just said, Kun fayakun. Be, and it became, right? And he came together. So we believe in the adab al-qabr, and we know Allah Azza wa Jalla is going to bring the person together. Are you with me? Ahlul Sunnah, we believe Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He brings the creation from wherever they are for that punishment of the grave. Those who don't believe it are the disbelievers. زعم الذين كفروا أن لا يبعثوا قل بلى وربي لتبعثن ثم لتنبؤن بما عملتم وذلك على الله. That to Allah is what? يسير. It's easy. It's not hard. It's not complicated. So it's between كن بي فيكون it will be. صح? So the person will come together. And the one who created is the one who created you now. Is the one, it's easy for him to bring you together. لخلق السماوات والأرض أكبر من خلق الناس. The creating of the samawat and the earth is more what? It's more harder. Nothing's hard to Allah than what? Than the creating of mankind. ولذلك, a man came to the Prophet ﷺ and he took ashes from the earth, and he said, "Ya Muhammad, are you telling us that when we become this, Allah is going to bring us together? Do you really think this is?" And he took the wind like that. In the face of the Prophet ﷺ. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقَهُ قَالَ مَنْ يُحْيِي الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَهَا أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٌ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ خَلْقٍ عَلِيمٌ Allah said, He's given us an example. He's picking up the earth and giving us a parable. Did He forget that the one who created you in the beginning, when there was, you didn't exist, is it not easy for Him to bring you back? Are you with me, brothers? Adab al-Qabr, brothers, there are many things that bring it about. From the things that bring about Adab al-Qabr, and many people are heedless about, is the ahadith and nusus mentioned, is praying salah without no tahara. The person who prays the salah with no tahara, and he's reached age of puberty, and he goes, "Oh, I have done wudu," and he just prays the salah. Adab al-Qabr comes from this. What's the evidence for that? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, أُمِرَ مَلَكٌ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ An angel from the angels was commanded to lash a man in his grave 100 lashes. Then when the man was informed that he's going to get lashed 100, he asked Allah, he said, "Oh Allah, please, don't, he cried. Then the angel was told, "Okay, lash him one." That one lash that was hit on him, مَلَأَ قَبْرُهُ نَارًا His whole grave burnt. All of it just burnt on him. Are you with me, brothers? And then the man, when he woke up, he said, "Alama jalatumuni." Why did you lash me for? What did I do? And then he said to him, the angel said to him, "لأنك صليت صلاة من غير طهارة." You prayed a salah with no tahara. I ask you, brothers, this is a person who prayed a salah with no tahara. What about the one who never prayed at all? Are we all together? From the things that come with adabul qabr is when the woman doesn't breastfeed her own children. She refuses to breastfeed. Adabul qabr. The Prophet ﷺ told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that the woman who doesn't breastfeed and refuses to breastfeed her child, for what, and if there's a reason for it, illness or whatnot, that's something else. Like if she doesn't want to do it, she refuses to breastfeed her child, the Prophet ﷺ told us that adabul qabr comes from it. And adabul qabr is what? A big snake will eat her breast. That's the punishment for her. So it's a severe issue. Well, لذلك, I advise you all to buy the kitab Ar-Ruh Ibn Al-Qayyim. What's the book? Kitab Ar-Ruh by Ibn Al-Qayyim. Ibn Al-Qayyim states the reasons why Adabul Qabr happens in that book. And he also states the things that will save you from gaining Adabul Qabr. I advise you, urge you all to read it. He brings each one with evidence. It's called what? Kitab Ar-Ruh. By the publication Dar Alim Al-Fawaid, that's the best publication. Reading Surah Al-Mulk will help us from the punishment of grave. Should we do it daily? Na'am. Sahih. The recitation of Surah Al-Mulk is one of the things that protect you from the what? The Adab Al-Qabr. The person should read it daily, of course. Daily they should read it. Daily they should read it. Anytime, na'am. Which
the man with the worst form of appearance that you mentioned in the Hadith of Samara at the end. You mentioned five.
The man in the narration mentioned?
The man that the Prophet said that he had the worst of appearance.
Let me look at the narration then. Na'am, that's the angel Malik Khazinun Nar. The angel that is what? That's protecting the hellfire. That angel doesn't have a soft appearance. Not only that, it said that the day he saw the hellfire, he never smiled after that. Are you with me? لِذَلِكَ when the people ask Malik for help, what did he say? قَالُوا يَا مَالِكُ لِيَقْضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّكُ قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. They said, Malik, you know, speak to Allah that just to judge us. We don't even want him to save us from the hellfire. But because there's going to be a period of time where Allah doesn't judge the people, that the people of the hellfire will just say, okay, we will go to the hellfire. Let him just judge us. That's how long the punishment is. And then the angel of Malik will say to them, إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. You guys are going to stay in the hellfire. You're going to taste the punishment and the adab will be on you. Are we all together? An angel, very staunch angel. Now, which one? Usury and?
The bank interest.
No. Yeah, usually it can happen in bank. It can happen between me and you without a bank involved. Usually is riba, right? And riba, it's a form of mu'amala, a form of business interaction or business transaction, which a person takes more than that which is his. Are you with me, brothers? So banks do it. The reason why I chose to use the word usury is because they mention interest. Do we believe riba is interest? Look at the word interest. Is riba interest? Allah says, يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى وَيُرْبِي الصَّدَقَاتِ. Allah is destroying riba. How can you say something Allah is destroying, there's interest in it? So they give it, yusammunaha bighayri ismiha. They give it a nice name. They call it interest. The nafs will like it. Just like some places in the world, they call drugs food. They call alcohol juice. Huh? Does that change the reality of it? They call zina affair. Sah? Will that change the reality of it being haram? So just because even sometimes it might have a nice name, Islamic finance, Islamic this, if you look at it and it becomes clear to you that it's riba, la yajuz, tawakuf, withhold. Whether a bank does it or whether or not, whether the bank has the name Islam in there or not, it doesn't change. You just have to look at the transaction, and if it's haram, leave it. From one of the transactions that people do nowadays is, for example, bay'u taqsit. Bay'u taqsit means what? Paying in installments. A person goes to a bank and he says, I want a car. The bank says, okay, which car do you want? The person says, I like this Lexus, or I like this, huh? The bank says, okay. The bank doesn't own the car. The bank does not? He doesn't own the car. So the bank says, okay, goes to the showroom, gets the car. You, on the other hand, say to the bank, get it for me. The bank says to you, if, how much does a car cost now? It costs 120,000. The bank says to you, I will take from you 180,000. And you pay in small installments. It's permissible so far what he said. So far it's what? So far it's permissible. 180,000 the car is, if you pay in small installments. But the problem is that he will say to you, you have to sign a contract now and you have to pay a deposit. Sah? True or false? That contract that you're paying, and that is first deposit that you're going to give, is haram. لا يجوز. Because what it should be is, when he buys the car and he brings it to his owner, he owns it. And so it doesn't become بيع ما لا يملك. He owns it, it's his own possession. Are we all together, brothers? He places that car in front of you, he says to you, now me and you are going to deal. And you have the right of saying, I terminate the decision, I don't want it anymore. You have the rights to say that. Do you have that right? No, they won't. They're going to lose out. They just bought a car that they didn't want. Are we all together? So there are transactions like that which are taking place. And then look, another problem is you have to pay a late payment. And they say that this late payment goes towards what? Sadaqah, charity. Fihi nadar. All of this needs looking. What does it do? It needs looking. Just take taxi like me. Yeah? Is it not good? Ah, fadda.
Can you say some words about the
Ha?
What is the word of the Ha? You said the Ha, right?
Ha. The Tahara is two types. Tahara means purification. Tahara is two types. There is Tahara, which is Sughra, Haddath Asghar or Akbar. Major or minor? Impurity. Major impurity is ma yujibul ghusl, anything that necessitates ghusl, showering yourself. And that is anything that comes after sexual intercourse and etc. The second one is what? Ma yujibul wudu, that which necessitates what? That which necessitates wudu. Like if you pass wind or if you go to the toilet and you do call of nature. Sah? Huh? That is wudu. Any of those two, if you pray a salah without it, the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say in the hadith? لا يقبل الله صلاة أحدكم إذا أحدث حتى يتوضأ. Allah does not accept the prayer of any one of you unless he prays with what? Unless he prays upon tahara. The hadith is in Sahihain, Bukhari and Muslim. I mentioned in the second hadith, Samurat ibn Jundub, these are all people who are believers, who are getting the punishment of the grave. So the one whose mouth was open and rock was in it. So all these are believers. They came with major sins. لَأَنَّ أَكْلُ الرِّبَى is not kufr, is it? It's a major sin.
But even for the small sins?
Small sins don't reach عذاب القبر. عذاب القبر is only what? And also kufr. The kufar are going to have عذاب القبر.
Can there be any situation where
No. Even if you do, you failed. It's impossible. No one, by the way, no one will be able to answer one or two questions. You see, it's not about whether you know it. That day you will not know it if you didn't live by it. It has to be a combination of knowledge and action, implementation. It's both of them. Like in right now, somebody might say, what's your religion? What's your Lord? And he might say, رَبِّيَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي خَلَقَنِي وَرَبَّانِي وَرَبَّ جَمِيعَ الْعَالَمِينَ بِنَعَمِي وَهُوَ مَعْبُودِي لَيْسَ لِي مَعْبُودٌ سِوَى. He knows that. But tomorrow when he's asked, مَنْ رَبُّكْ? He'll say, are we all together? It's about amal. You see, our religion is a component of beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياتي ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. Our religion is between what? It's about beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. It's not just knowledge by itself. والعصر إن الإنسان في خسر إلا الذين آمنوا. آمنوا here means علم. وعملوا الصالحات means what? Righteous deeds. Muhammad Abdul Wahhab says in his kitab, the three qawa'id book, what does he say? What's the first one? العلم هو معرفة الله ومعرفة نبي ومعرفة دين الإسلام بالأدلة. والثاني العمل الصالح. والثالث الدعوة إلى الله. والرابع الصبر على الأذى فيه. And then he brings والدليل قوله والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. We mentioned the hadith of Anas. Remember, the punishment for backbiting and gossiping and eating people's honor and reputation. We said that the Prophet ﷺ, he said that in that hadith, that a people who what? They will have nails made out of metal rod and they will rip their chest and their faces. And then he said, فَقُلْتُ يَا جِبْرِيلُ. I said, oh Jibreel, who are these people? And then he said, هَؤُلَاءِ الَّذِينَ يَقَعُونَ فِي أَعْرَاضِ النَّاسِ. They are the ones who يَأْكُلُونَ لُحُومُ النَّاسِ وَيَقَعُونَ فِي أَعْرَاضِهِمْ. They are the ones who are eating the people's flesh and they are dishonoring and disrespecting people's honor. So backbiting and speaking about people's honor, it's one of the things that bring what? عذاب القبر. It brings عذاب القبر. Especially if you're spreading hate between people. You know the famous hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, and Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi brought in his kitab Umdatul Ahkam, where the Prophet ﷺ, he went by a grave and then he said, إِنَّهُمَ لَيُعَذَّبَانِ. The two people in this grave are being punished. وَمَا يُعَذَّبَانِ فِي كَبِيرٍ. They are not being punished in something very big, meaning it's something it was so easy for them to stay away from. What was the first one? إِنَّهُ كَانَ يَمْشِي بَيْنَ النَّاسِ بِالنَّمِيمَةِ. أما كَانَ لَا يَسْتَتِرُ مِنَ الْبَوْلِ. This one, he never used to clean himself from the urine. عَلَابُ الْقَبْرِ. The second one was what? كَانَ يَمْشِي بَيْنَ النَّاسِ بِالنَّمِيمَةِ. He was a tale bearer. What does that mean? He goes to a person, says, do you know what he said about you? Wallahi, you don't know what he said about you. Next one. Allah. Wallahi, he responded. And guess what he said? All day he's going around. Isn't it even worse? Billahi alaikum. Adabul qabr comes from namima, right? Tale bearing. Imagine if you're doing tale bearing between scholars and people of knowledge. And you make scholars not speak to each other, not talk to each other, because you spread rumors between them. Doesn't the matter become more serious? Huh? Between the normal people, adab al-qabr comes from it. Imagine ulama, you make them not speak to each other, you make them turn away from one another, it becomes even more severe. As Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentions in his kitab, Mujmal al-i'tiqad Ahl al-Sunnah. Any other questions? Can you do actions for the people in their graves? Like your family members have died. Can you do things on their behalf? Some scholars, they said any righteous actions that you do mutlaqan, unrestrictedly, it can go towards the grave. And some of the ulama, they said, لا. illa ma dalla ad-dalil alayh. Anything that the evidence show that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said that you can do for your loved ones in their grave, these are the only actions that can go to them. Like if you do sadaqah for on their behalf, there are evidence for that. Are we all together? Also, if you're a righteous son or a righteous child, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith, ينقطع عمل ابن آدم إلا من ثلاثة. لا ينقطع عمل ابن آدم إلا من ثلاثة. The actions of the children of Adam does not disconnect except three. One of them is what? ولد صالح يدعو له. A righteous son or a daughter who makes dua for their parents. That's one. And from them is also what? صدقة جارية. أو علم ينتفع به. So you open a madrasa on his name, or you give a well, sadaqah for them. All this will carry on, inshallah ta'ala. Last question, inshallah ta'ala. Is this country, is the insurance obligatory? You have to take insurance. You have to. You can't drive the car without insurance.
Medical,
huh?
Medical, car,
medical. Everything has to be insurance. Huh?
So, can we take benefits from that medical insurance, or will it be without you?
Allahu A'lam. Ask the scholars, inshallah ta'ala. Because I haven't looked into the insurance, I haven't seen it. وَالْكُلُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَنَاحِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ يَقُولُ لَا أَدْرِي فَكُنْ مُتَّبِعَةِ لَا أَدْرِي, I don't know. Allah, I don't know. I haven't looked into it, and I don't know. So, Allahu A'lam. Ask the people of knowledge, they might tell you, inshallah ta'ala. BarakAllahu feekum, wa jazakum Allah khairan.